So this is week three of prayers and meditations, batch 7. And we have two prayers with us, February 5, 1914, and February 7, 1914. So let us start with this first one, which is more like an invocation, really, and just like all prayers also, and a short one. So let us begin with this and then we can first read the prayer. Whoever wants to share first may read the prayer first and share whatever comes to you about the prayer. So whoever wants to go first, please unmute and go ahead.
Namaste, Dr. Monica.
Namaste, Rashmi ji. Yeah, please share.
February 5, 1914. What could be said that is not always the very same aspiration? The law of divine love, the purest expression of what we can conceive of thee, must be realized more and more upon earth and triumph over all ignorant egoism. We must become more and more perfectly the faithful servitors of that power of love and light. We must live in it, by it, that alone must live and act in us. O Lord, become the sovereign master of our lives. Dispel all the obscurities which can still prevent us from seeing thee and constantly communing with thee. Liberate us from all ignorance. Liberate us from ourselves, that we may open wide the doors of thy glorious manifestation. Dr. Monica, others start. I'll come back later on.
Okay, sure. Thank you for reading it out, Rashmiji. So anyone who feels ready, if there were a few lines or more that resonated with you and anything that comes to you which you want to share with us.
Yeah, I'll go, Monica.
Yes, Chitra.
Actually, when I read this prayer about love, yeah, mother stressed upon that actually. Yeah, mother is full of love. Whenever I think of mother itself, only love. Because whatever the struggles or whatever the darkness in the surface level and that surface mind or vital or physical, it is not, whenever it revolves, even if it revolves against this path, actually, something in us would, actually pull me towards the mother. That I feel it is her love only. Yeah. Because of her love touch the true inner being, always that journey is going till today, that so I feel she's the embodiment of love. She is the true love. A little of it, even if we touch it, no, yeah, that will give us great relief from all the ills and all the sufferings and everything. Because one episode came to me actually when Hutadi, one of the sadhaka in the ashram, she was no more now. But when she used to have that mood of depression often actually. And once when she went to see mother with a lot of depressing mood, she threw away the flowers mother gave to her. Then went back as if she wanted to go away from the ashram finally. But after some time, mother sent one of her, close ladies, some, I think was Daben, I don't know their name now, I don't remember the name. She went and told Huda. First, Huda even refused to hear the thing, actually. But after some time, with all tears in her eyes, she would be able to hear what mother told about the incident. And she told, that lady told Huda, well, you know what mother told about you, your revolt and all? She said, actually, mother said, she doesn't know how she loves me from internally. When Alukda pointed out this, mother never told she loves Hutadi, but how Hutadi loves internally mother. That is the main point, actually. Yeah, for every one of us, I feel that love only brought us here. Yeah, that is the true love. Because in the second pair also, O Lord, become the sovereign master of our lives and dispel all the obscurities. Only that love can do that, which can still prevent us from seeing thee and constantly communing with thee. Yes, nothing else, only love can do that. I feel like that. And also in Savitri also, when very particularly, all there are so many lines about that love, but when the debate of love and death is coming, this is a beautiful line. I will read that line actually. All is itself, all is new felt in God. A lover leaning from his cloister's door gathers the whole world into his single breast. Then shall the business fail of night and death. When unity is won, when strife is lost, and all is known, and all is clasped by love, who would turn back to ignorance and pain? Yeah, these are the very important lines. I used to read these lines always. So this prayer reminded me of those things. There are so many other lines also in that canto, especially it is canto 3 in book 10, actually. Yeah. 10, debate of love and death. When Savitri had an argument with the god of death, she emphasized about the importance of the love. So very beautiful lines they are, how love liberates us from all ignorance. Here also same thing, liberate us from ourselves and that we may open wide the doors of thy glorious manifestation. Yes, love, it is mother. Mother's another name is love, I feel. Thank you, Monica. This is
yeah, amazing. Beautiful. Thank you so much, yeah. Chitraji. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, anyone who wants to go next? Anything you have to share? Any few lines which were, yeah. Yes, Shweta.
No, very beautifully reflected on by Chitraji. So I don't have anything to add, but the whole prayer, you know, every word, every sentence, I feel that, you know, I can read repeatedly, and it's such a personal prayer, and like you feel so nice reading this, you know, like we all, every word, every sentence, so it's very beautiful. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Shweta. Yes. Yeah, anyone else who wants to share on this prayer? I think Ashpriya has left. Ashpriya, you have anything to add on, or maybe share a personal reflection of yours? Yes. Yes.
Nothing. I'm just listening and trying to be in this space. As of now, there is nothing else that I can talk about. But the fact that, you know, must this line where it is talking about, you know, must be realized more and more upon earth and triumph over all ignorant egoism. we must become more and more perfect, the faithful servitors of that power of love and light. We must live in it, by it, that alone must live and act in it. So that, you know, living in that love is something, you know, which we constantly grow in. I mean, I think that's a constant practice, and consciously we have to, I think, practice at times, and because there are so many ways our egos come in our way, and we don't realize that love that exists. And with surrender, I think we kind of feel that love more and more in us.
Yeah. Yes. It's you know, yes, Rashmi ji, please go ahead.
What I understand from this prayer little bit, divine is the purest expression of love, is the purest expression of divine, which should be realized more and more upon earth, because all our egoisms are ignorant. So Mother has used a wonderful adjective here, ignorant egoism. So egoism in any form is always ignorant. So love, being the purest expression of the divine, can triumph over the egoism. And what another point that really touched me, not only the love has to liberate us, because we are divine, love is the purest expression of divine, and which can liberate us from ignorance. And the beautiful thing is here, that liberate us from ourselves. That is a wonderful thing, because we are the fetters. We are putting all the fetters through our egoism. So that is the most important thing to do, going beyond ourselves. And another thing is that we must live in it, by it. And that alone, love and light, both the things. We must live in it, by it. So our acts must be in such a way that we must express that love and light in our actions. And in our lives also, it should be reflected. Our lives itself be an expression of love and light. And that will only happen when we liberate us from ourselves. That is what we are praying to the Sovereign Master. Please dispel all the obscurities which prevents us from seeing Thee. And those obscurities which are constantly, actually, which are preventing us from our constant communion with the divine. So they're all, I think they're all stepwise processes that Mother has given. And as Swetaji and Chitraji already explained wonderfully, that surrender is the key here. So that we become expression of love and light. Thank you.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you so much, Rashmiji. Thank you. So I think this is very important. The last paragraph, this line, liberate us from ourselves. I think Rashmiji stressed upon it. And we think that it's situations and life situations and maybe people in my life owing to whom I am suffocated and maybe miserable. But if we look closely, if we go closely, we see that it's our clinging to our own ideas and conceptions of truth, our clinging to our thoughts, our clinging to our feelings, our clinging to life situations. This is the way how it should be and why is it not like this? And also clinging to people in our life. So basically our clinging is the reason of all misery in our life. And slowly as we become aware of it, we realize, I think it gives us a lot of power back if we realize that the game is played by me rather than the game being played by other people and situations in my life. So I have to liberate my from my own clutches. You know, I have to just let it go. You know, let it go. That's what when we talk about surrender. You know, that's letting it go. So either you're letting it go to something higher than you, or maybe the mother, those who have faith in the mother, the divine in any form. The basic is just letting it go. Why? Because we are so sticky in nature that we stick to everything. We stick to our conceptions of how life should be. We stick to how people should be around me. We stick to what people should be thinking around me, you know, about me. And we also stick to our, especially our images about ourselves, that this is how I am, this is who I am. And if anybody says anything against that, I am insulted. Why? Because I have an image I'm sticking to. So I think the whole crux of the matter is, can we liberate ourselves in this life itself? Not waiting for the other life to come. Can I not cling to whatever I find myself clinging to? So becoming conscious is a very, very essential part of this journey, because if I'm not even conscious of what I'm clinging to, how would I let it go? And that's why people who criticize us or, you know, come opposite, are in kind of opposition, they are beautiful you know, partners in this journey. Why? Because they let us know what is clinging to me. And when their role is over, we see that slowly either they change or the paths change so that those people are not around. But as long as we need them in our life, they will be poking here and there, doing ungli here and there, because maybe we need that poking, you know, because we stick to our ideas. And especially, you know, when on spiritual path, we stick to spiritual ideas. So I was talking to someone who was going through a difficult patch in life and something like a divorce or separation. And he is into, you know, mothers and Sri Aurobindo's philosophy. And it was very saddening to see that how he was, the attitude that he was taking at this, which is a very challenging condition. It's no doubt that it's a very challenging condition. But although I'm saying that I am a disciple of devotee of Mother and Sri Aurobindo, and yet the stance I'm taking is that those other people are asuras and I am the one who has to fight this dharma youth. You know? So we take a high moral ground when we are on this spiritual path, and that's what sticks to us. You know, so we begin to think that mera to ho gaya, tumhara kab hoga, you know, I am all fixed, but you tell me, you know, that when will you get corrected? And that's the, it's not that game, you know, it's just the old game of the ego filled with the sense of lack and wanting to become superior going on and on. Nothing has changed really. No surrender has come into being. And on the top of it, I'm also using the name of Mother and Sri Aurobindo that, you know, look, I am doing some divine work. So that's really crazy. I found it really crazy that how we can be fooled into this, you know, thinking that I am doing something divine and other people are not. And while all the while I'm just suffocated in my own sense of separate self, you know, so this liberates us from ourselves. And the moment I connect deeply with my own pristine awareness, which is behind every thought, awareness which is behind every feeling, awareness which is behind every so-called phenomenon, and know myself as that awareness, I think there we touch upon something which is very pure, luminous, and full of love, which does not want anything from anyone. Now that awareness is absolutely pristine, clear. And the more and more I stabilize myself as that pure awareness, I see that my dogmas and opinions and rigidities, they all wither away, like they fall away. They make no sense at all. And then forgiveness, you know, then there is no point of forgiving other people, because you see that if they were at fault, I was also at fault because I was identifying with my thoughts and feelings. And that's what an ego does. That's how the ego is created. An identification with the thoughts and feelings. So how to liberate ourselves from our own clutches? Not to identify ourselves with thoughts and feelings and whatever our opinions and ideas may be. To take them very, very loosely. Not to believe in our thought and feelings so strongly. And then we unburden ourselves. Then we become lighter. And then we are also in that moment, at least, we are liberated from a sense of ignorance. And whenever I am identified with lots of thoughts and lots of feelings, I'm always under a dark cloud, which is a cloud of ignorance. And whenever I take a step back, know myself as this awareness, which is behind every thought, behind every feeling, stabilize myself there, know myself as that, there the cloud is dissipated. So in that moment, I liberate myself from that ignorance. Without that, we can never know what true love is. Because that, the moment I get in touch with that pristine awareness, knowing, as we say, you know, become aware of being aware. When we place our focus there, you're sitting in your dhyan or meditation, whatever you're doing, and you suddenly become aware of being aware. Rather than being aware of thoughts and feelings and sensations, where we are mostly lost. Mm-hmm. So the moment we touch this space, this space itself is full of love. And it's unconditional love because it pours itself out on whoever kind of touches it. It is not biased that this is my family, only this is to be loved and the other ones not to be loved. So there is no separation in that level of consciousness. And only then, without knowing ourselves who we truly are, we cannot liberate ourselves from the clutches of ignorance. And hence, we cannot actually do any good to the society and our, you know, the love, even near ones or the far ones. So if we are to walk on this path of self-realization or the spiritual path, it's also like a prayer that let me do it for everyone else. Because when I begin to walk on this path, then I become less of a drain and more of a flower. So this is my responsibility to walk on this path for not only for me, but for everyone else. You know, otherwise with the egoistic frame of consciousness, what a torture we are to other people. And we need more and more flowers rather than more and more, you know, blocked drains around us. And then it is by its side effect, you know, the side effect of it is that we live in the power of love and light, and we let alone live it in us. Why? Because we then, the more and more you stabilize yourself in this sense of I am aware of being aware, you know, rooting yourself there, you see that you cannot do any egoistic act. The moment you do it, you feel a sense of great unease. And Mother shares in prayers and meditations, other few ones that we have covered, that I sense a pang in my heart, you know, that something is wrong, something is there which I did wrong. But usually when we are running into an egoistic frame of consciousness, then this pang is missing. You know, the wrong appears to be okay. But the moment more and more my own true nature becomes more natural for me, then after that, any drop of pinch of egoism, it appears like dal mein kuch kala hai. You know, kuch hua jo aaj theek nahi tha. You know, something happened which was not right. So let me reflect over it. You know, and then you're able to work on it, you know, shed light on it, or maybe offer it to the mother, let it go. So it's a long way for each one of us, but I think the journey has to start now, because although in eternity we have enough time, but human mortal existence is a limited time that we have. So can we begin the journey right now of identifying with my true nature, becoming aware of being aware, knowing myself as this awareness, rather than knowing myself as those thoughts, stories, past, future, worries, anxieties, and feelings. You know, so dissociating from them and actually reclaiming our throne back in our own self. So yeah, I think that's what I could reflect upon here. Yeah.
So beautiful, Monica. It was very beautiful, your reflection. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, wonderful.
Yeah, thank you, Rashmi.
Not to be a drain, but to blossom like a flower.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
So let us continue to the next prayer in that case. Anitaji, we have just covered the first prayer. And in case you would have any reflections at any point of time, please come up and unmute and share.
I will. Today being my first day,
yeah.
So I'm trying to understand.
Okay. Sure.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
Yeah, good to have you here. So let us go to Feb 7 then. Feb 7. And whoever wants to share first, I would request to read the prayer and then please share your reflections. Yeah, maybe a little bigger would be better. Yeah. Whoever wants to read the prayer, and then we will share reflections.
Can I just read the prayer first? Like maybe reflection I can do later.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah,
please.
Yeah. So, February 7, 1914. For him who by being integrally united with thee is constantly conscious of what expresses thee most perfectly in action, considering the circumstances, no external rule is any longer necessary. The principles of life are in sum only makeshifts for diminishing as far as possible the ignorance of those who do not know thee yet, and for counteracting somehow or other, the moments of blindness and obscurity of those who have only an intermittent contact with thee. To make rules for oneself and to make them as general, that is, as supple as possible, is good, but provided one considers them only as artificial lights, which should not be used except when the full natural light of communion with thee fails. Besides, a constant revision of these rules is imperative, for they can be only the expression of a present knowledge and must necessarily gain by all growth and improvement of knowledge. So true. That is why when meditating upon the attitude one should have towards all those who come to us, in order not only to refrain from doing them any harm, but above all to strive to do them the utmost possible good, that is, to help them as best one can in making the supreme discovery, the discovery of thee within them. I saw clearly that no rule was vast and supple enough to be perfectly adapted to thy law, and that the only true solution was to be always in communion with thee, and so that it could be adapted perfectly to all the infinite variety of circumstances. Beautiful.
Yeah.
All I can say right now is that, you know, I slowly get this now, you know, like in the process, long way to go, but yes, all this I can understand now. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah. It's almost like, you know, a language which was first maybe Greek and Latin to us, and
yes.
Slowly the words become, you know, alive and meaningful. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, so anyone who feels like sharing something on this prayer,
Yeah, Monica.
Yes, yeah. Chitraji. Yes.
Yeah, when I read this prayer, it reminded me of my old days, actually. I used to do a lot of, rituals. Correct time, you have to get up early in the morning and do all those things. Very strict, actually, it is all. But slowly, that after, fortunately, mother came into the life. Actually, those things, without even my knowledge, those things started changing, actually. Those timings are there, of course, early morning and late in the night, during bedtime, those timings are there, but those timings become more of a communication with the divine, not of doing all the rituals and all. Maybe those rituals prepared me, I feel like that, towards this communication and all with the divine. And as mother said, the principles of life are in some only makeshifts for diminishing as far as possible the ignorance of those who do not know thee yet. Yes, it is very true. When we realize that true essence of the divinity, it is inside you and you have to pursue that, the outer things are slowly falling away, that I felt actually, really I felt. I have gone through this, so it is a very suitable prayer for me, I feel actually. And also to make rules for oneself and to make them as general, as supple as possible. This is a very nice thing actually, yes, it's good. But provided one considers them only as artificial lights, yes. After coming a long way, I feel, yes, those are artificial lights. But now that it become very real, actually, communicating with the divine and even that meditation and concentration, that time it was different. Now it is totally different, actually. So that feeling is always there. And also, this third paragraph, that is why when meditating upon the attitude one should have towards all those who come to us in order not only to refrain from doing them any harm, but above all, to strive to do them the utmost possible good. That is to help them as best as one can in making the supreme discovery. Yeah, this is very beautiful. Yes, this is the real help. No, you always use tell no in all the sessions. That is the real help, more than anything, to find that is the supreme discovery of everyone. We should help ourselves also. We should help others also in that path, I feel. Yeah, it is very beautiful. And a very deep prayer, this one is. Yeah, this is my take. Yes, thank you.
Beautiful. Mom. Thank you. Yeah. Beautiful.
Very profound are these two sentences.
Yeah.
Because personally for me, I've reached a point, we all know you're not doing any harm, but this is the step forward, which, I see in many, many people around, but yeah, this is something to pursue also in future, I feel, to strive to do them the utmost possible good, that is to help them as best one can in making the supreme discovery, the discovery of thee within them. So this, I think, I have not taken as, something that because of own nature also, it's intrusion, I should not do it. But yeah, this I feel is the take home for me today. Yeah.
Yes, beautiful. Yes. I think the more we exit out of this separate sense of self, then we don't really mind even intruding into others for their, when we know that we mean no harm and we mean good only. So then this separative sense of living, that also withers away, as I think Chitraji was pointing out, that yeah. The outer drops off. Yeah,
it drops off. Yeah.
Beautiful. Yes. Yeah. Anyone who wants to share next?
So, you know, this is very relatable for me, extremely relatable. Because I think for me, every individual has his or her own way to relate to the divine. And in, you know, and all of them are actually true. I feel that, you know, that nothing is, you know, there could be no norms of, you know, connecting to the divine, I think. And the divine also has so many, you know, innumerable ways to, you know, manifest, and innumerable ways to show that, you know, the colors and the magnificence of the divine. I think, and if we can appreciate that, and if we can feel that, you know, there is a oneness in everything, then that our society today is so much filled with exclusion. I think that can slowly go away. You know, somewhere, and that has to come from within, and it cannot come from, you know, it cannot come as a norm, as a, you know, or as something which we have to do, as a compulsion. It has to come from within, and if that happens, I think most of the things can be solved. Yeah. Hello.
Yes, Ashpriya. Yeah. Yes. Anything more, Ashpriya? I thought
I think one of the things which I have felt when I thought about this, and this, you know, feeling of oneness is something which I can relate to a lot. You know, for us, it is so easy to say that, you know, it is easy to do, not even to say, to do it for others. But, you know, we are extremely sensitive when it comes to people who are very near to us, you know, like our, you know, immediate family, and, you know, and we get to see so many aspects of that person that, you know, to find something which is absolutely beautiful in that person at times become very difficult. Because that also, you know, our identity is so many, it's very complicated, you know, so many things are associated with that person. And to really live that, with that feeling that, no, there is no separation, there is no, you know, there is divine in that person also. And, you know, it's beautiful to have that person as just the way that person is in my life. This is a journey in itself, and I won't say challenge, because you know, it is a blessing in disguise to have this kind of an understanding, and this kind of a person to start with, and then slowly to have that understanding that this was a blessing for me, you know, and to basically to, I don't know whether I'm very and am I clear to all of you, or is it very complicated?
No, I think it's relatively clear, Ashpriya, what you are sharing.
And it's very difficult, you know, at times, because, you know, that I know that that person has extremely good quality, but at the same time, you know, that ego is also playing in that other person. And it's not that we cannot be, we cannot unsee that aspect of the other person, and yet you know that there is something beyond that which exists between us, and that needs to be, and that is divine, I think, you know, that which is more than all of these things, which is apparent, which belongs to this life only, I think.
Yeah,
but beyond that. So I was actually reading a book I'm still reading that book, which talks about, you know, how we, how this is a karmic thing also for us. Like, for example, if we suffer from certain emotion troubles us a lot, there is a possibility, and especially if we are on a spiritual path, there is a possibility that that emotion will actually heighten to release us from that particular aspect. And if we are true to that emotion, we will experience that emotion to the fullest, and then it will go. That is actually this year we become really authentic to whatever life is giving to us. And not, you know, and this is a trap, I think, and I've seen that I've seen that with people who are on the spiritual path, that they feel that they are immune to all of these things, and they don't want to feel all of these emotions, and then don't remain true. And you know, so mother had said this to someone, that you know, you need not do a lot of things, just be simple and be open towards me. It sounds very simple, but it isn't actually that simple. I think if I can do that much, I think that would be a great thing to do, that just to be simple and be always open towards mother. I think that is something which I'm trying to do.
Beautiful. Very powerful. You know, to be simple is not that simple.
Yeah. Because in simplicity means what? Authentic. And you know, being authentic in each and every way. Actually, I couldn't finish that course, but I'd done a course of dance movement therapy, where actually our body, because a lot of things we don't understand, it is stored in our body. So that spontaneity is gone slowly with aging and with a lot of experiences. The spontaneity is gone. Now, if we are aware and if we are connected enough, our mind and body and everything is connected enough, we will be, you know, spontaneous and authentic in each and every act that we do. So it is a whole life, I think, is yoga that way, that we have to keep on doing that. It is very simple to say that we have to be simple. It isn't that simple.
Beautiful. Yeah, very, very important and relevant and beautifully said. Yes. Yeah, I think as you were sharing, that we have to just continue, keep shedding whatever accumulates, you know, because from time to time something or the other gets accumulated in us, which stops and blocks that spontaneity. It's almost like a, you know, jo nali ka flow hota hai na, flow of a drain. As for from time to time, you have to put some material so that the, you know, the blockage is off. Yeah.
I think now that we are trying to be at least more conscious, it will come more. I think this is what I have been feeling more lately, that it is that actually it will intensify. A lot of things will intensify. This is my own thing. Might not be true for everyone. Just my own thing. That it a lot of things actually intensify, even events, even the circumstances, lot of things. I mean, in the past 1 or 2 months, too many things happening, and lot of intense emotion. And now that the challenge is actually to accept all of those intensity with courage, with patience, and with authenticity. Yes, you know, this can also happen. Oh, this. I thought this is going to happen, but this is not, that did not happen. Something else immediately after that is happening. And then, you know, sometimes it's like, oh, I don't even know, you know, what is happening. So that itself, I think that intensity, I think that is a blessing for me. If I can say that, it is a blessing. That is, you know, that something is intensely happening to you. And in most of these cases, when I'm saying intensely happy, it actually comes with a lot of emotion. It does not just come and go. There are a lot of emotions involved. Both, you know, if we think about it, both positive and negative. But it comes with a lot of emotion. And there's a lot of churning happening. And at times I'm lost words, you know, just to... That's why a lot of these sessions I've been really silent, because I don't know really how to process, how to really be authentic to my emotions, be authentic to everyone else also, the reaction which I am giving and all of this. But I, in this, I think, you know, I'm trying to surrender more and more that this is what is happening. This is, I don't care about my image. I don't care about, you know, it's just that I need to be authentic. And
yeah,
when I'm saying it, it might sound very adventurous and beautiful.
Yeah, not a cup of tea, huh? Not an easy cup of tea.
Yeah. I mean, internally, it is not beautiful. It is not easy.
No, absolutely. I think what you were sharing, the intensity, how these things come up with more and more intensity, I think that has a reason also, that the more we become prepared to take it in its intensity, as if, you know, like you have passed class 9, so you are given the examination of class 10, 11, 12, because you are now getting prepared. So I feel that the more we become ready to take things in life, you know, head on, the more strength we accumulate through our life situations. I absolutely, I'm sure others would also agree that we become ready to head on, take more intense experiences, and it's only, they are coming only so that we can gradually kind of shed everything off, whatever needs to be shed off through those experiences.
And be really open, I think.
And that be really open, yeah. Yeah.
That we think that, oh, this is a spiritual life which I can choose, which we often associate with. And it is true. It is true that, you know, slowness, which is true. But if life is not giving you that, what can you do?
Absolutely.
What can you do?
Yeah.
You know, you can just, you know, be in awe of everything that is being given to you and take them as gift.
Beautiful.
Take them. Beautiful. That's it.
Absolutely. Very powerful. Yes. Beautiful. You know, what you were sharing, being authentic is so difficult. I think Gabor Mate, who has done a lot of work with addictions, you know, people who are falling into addictions, he shares that, why do we not want to be ourselves truly? Because it's too painful. You know, it's easier to give in to some addiction and to numb our true authenticity, rather than to be authentically yourself. So it's painful. It's not an easy journey. Totally agree with what you were sharing. It takes a lot of courage, strength, and again, many intensities have to be kind of confronted with if you want to live a so-called simple and authentic life. Yeah.
And also accept the fact that I'm not unable to at times.
Yeah.
I mean, at times it is important. I mean, I'm not yet ready enough. And pray that, you know, give me that strength. Like there is a very nice Tagore song which says that Bipode mujhe rokha karo enohe mor prarthana, Bipode ami na jarna kori bhoy. Which translates like, you know, I'm not asking, oh Lord, I'm not asking you to protect me from danger, but when danger comes, give me the strength and the courage to face it.
Beautiful.
Don't save me, but give me that courage.
Amazing. Yeah. I think this is what we can pray, actually, what you just shared, you know, when we are looking at our loved ones, maybe someone is going through a challenge, we want to help, but we can't really do much. I think this can be a prayer that may the higher intelligence, the divine, give them the strength and courage to face whatever is, you know, that they are going through.
I think, and it is, to be honest, if this is there, because in life everything cannot be positive, so, but the courage and the patience part and honesty, this is what we can all strive
rest,
for. Yeah, rest everything we really can't. Although there is this book, that the book which I was reading, because there was in that last prayer there was this mention of manifestation, right? Actually, a lot of this thing, apparently we only create those. So in our mind, we have already created that particular incident, and it has manifested. It is just a manifestation in this reality. So, like, this is just a theory. I'm just sharing. So, in lot of, there's a belief that there are many worlds. So, in one of those worlds, this has happened. Basically, your mind has captured that, and this is the reflection of that in this life, this reality, in this world.
Yes, please go on. I think the moment we change our attitude to whatever is happening, we can actually shift our reality. I think that's the biggest challenge.
This with a lot of intensity of emotions and incidents in your life, I think this automatically you become more aware of this particular ability that you have.
Beautiful.
This was something which I used to think requires this kind of approach. Now it has shifted and it's fine. I am fine. Everything is fine. Why was I thinking that was the only way? This is also another way. So I think, and also I think we most of us have become so we lack flexibility in so many. I am talking about myself. I used to lack flexibility of, understanding of adaptability and all of this. We think that, this is not happening. We start complaining. This is not happening. We start complaining. And we run from one thing to another, one thing to another. And then we realize we need not run. It's okay. It's just about, changing that mind.
Beautiful. I think it also gives us our power back the moment we take that attitude. Yeah. Beautiful.
And it's now that I think, I've been running from one thing to another and I've tired myself so much.
Exactly.
Just fatigued.
Yeah.
No, this was not required. I feel that, such a fool I was, to have just exhausted myself in things which was not so important.
And now thinking about that, I exhausted myself. I am exhausting my further exhausting myself.
It is.
But true. I think but I think it's also about the readiness. You had to exhaust yourself to be ready for this. I feel personally, you go through all that, but you also understand that the readiness is now and it's because of all that. So I think everybody will have a journey, smaller, shorter or longer. But that's what, brings me to this point again, to strive to them the utmost possible good, that is to help them as best one can in making supreme discovery, the discovery of the within them. So usually what I feel is, going by my own journey, you get it when you get it, and then suddenly you get it, and also the intensity which Priya was telling, suddenly so much happens with so much intensity, and then you feel your readiness for those challenges are also more. So personally, I feel it's been a journey, and that makes me always, I come back to this point, whether, to get into telling this, or, when I see many people, just suffering, I also feel is it my place to tell them, because I by my own journey I understand that they will have their journey. So you can just be that person, but who's living what you believe, but also how much to move forward on, tell them about this, because sometimes I feel it also offends them, especially when they're suffering. They just want your presence, to just be there for me. Don't tell me anything, So that is where I feel I don't know when to take it forward to, loved ones.
Yeah, I think this is true. But, you know, it is also true that, you know, to be, again, to be authentic. Here also, I think that the key is to be authentic. I mean, I did not know about so many things, say, 10 years back. But then also, you know, and then also, I'm, you know, in various ways, many people have helped me. I had, and I'm sure it was because this space itself was not so, people did not discuss about so many things. So, but yet people helped me, I helped them. And there was a, you know, immediate understanding that yes, that other person is helping me. You know, whatever that other person is saying is because that other person really wants to help me. Of course, you are like continuously saying, oh, do this. It is instruction is another thing. And when you really mm-hmm. want to help someone, in you know, that when you know that when you can trust that other person, I think that is the key, that whether you that other person you trust or not. And even if at times, and at times my friends have also, you know, gone ahead, said things which I did not agree to and whatever, but yet I know that that person really wants me to you know, be better and really thinks about my well-being. So that trust is there. I think here also authentic, being authentic really, really helps. And this is from my own experience.
Yeah, but Aspriya, I feel being authentic will keep changing because, you know, sometimes I have personally realized that being authentic would be just being like, you know, for me, it's been like just like you said, na, like being with the mother and, you know, just praying and just, you know, like it's about bringing the attention back to yourself and, you know, understanding it better for yourself. And the more you relate to and connect to personally, like I've connected to my own self, I felt I felt peace also. And that faith, yeah, sometimes I do get it that, you know, as as a message, or, you know, like simply as like, you know, like this thing also, you know, if you would like to read, like I just offer it like that. But it just changes from situation to situation, I feel.
Yeah, I mean, I think it changes from that person, one person to another person also. If I may say this, it actually, I think for me, it depends on my energy on that day, that other person's energy on that day.
Absolutely.
And, you know, the energy thing, I think matters a lot. I have gone to therapist and I have felt that person is not at all for me. And I'm sure that person is actually good for some other person, but that's fine. But that person is not really not. I think your energy matters.
And I think like Monica says, you know, there is no other. So that has helped me a lot, you know. The more I focus on myself and, you know, like just focus on, you know, mother and, you know, like any divine being, I feel that gives more clarity largely. So that has been my journey. Yeah.
It actually, in, you know, from all of the experience that I've been having, the only thing which I am wary about is that, you know, it should not become like I. Oh, this is happening to me. This is happening to me. This is something which I think it is important to be conscious of that thing, that it isn't about I. Because this is also another trap of on when one is on the spiritual path.
Yeah, absolutely. Totally. I get that.
Yeah, beautiful discussion, Ashpriya and Shweta, the sharings and reflections. And as Shweta was sharing that, you know, all those exhaustions were maybe necessary for us to be here today, you know, and reading about all this, and maybe whatever we are going through right now is necessary for maybe something coming ahead. You know, that's how we kind of continue. So, you know, there is no formula. Truth has no formula, as I think you both were also discussing, that we cannot set a rule or a pattern that what is the best way to help the other person. Many a times a prayer is the best way to help another person. And many a times, maybe an action may be a beautiful way to help the other person. And what is suitable for that moment would be just guided. You know, we will be having the inner guidance to actually make that happen, you know, whatever is necessary. And as we were sharing the last time also, I think, and mother also shares that the best you can do to help the other person is truly say a prayer. Truly say a prayer for him that may that person get all the strength and the courage to go through this process. May he get in touch with his own true self. Truly, if a prayer is said truly, I think that is the biggest help one can do without even externally doing much. You know, that we were talking about whether to poke someone to read a book or, you know, maybe something. Although these actions obviously from time to time become necessary. Whenever we find a right moment, we kind of throw something in front. But many a times when things are mostly out of control, why? Because we live in egoistic consciousness and ego is not ready to receive. You know, we talk about the three kinds of ego, the tamasic, rajasic, and the, you know, the sattvic ego. Sattvic is the last step of the kind of, you know, a kind of a supple and more receptive egoistic consciousness. Even that has to be transcended, right? So it's very beautiful if people are already in the sattvic state, but most of us are not in the sattvic state. Most of us. It's very rare and painful occasions that we become receptive. Achha, achha, bata, chal, kya keh rahi hai, tu, main sun lu. Because, you know, humari pitai ho rahi hai. So only in very, very tragic situations, the ego becomes a little sattvic, more open, more receptive. Most often than not, we are not there. We are very blocked. So it's very hard to help anyone. The best I can do to help anyone is first be that beauty, my own self, that I want in the other. Mother also says, be that perfection in your own self that you want in the other. Again, the focus comes back on you. And the other is to silently do your prayers. I mean, no one can know that. And today I am feeling so well. Think about it. Today you are feeling well. You don't know who on earth was saying prayers that may all beings be well and may all beings be happy. We have no idea what is happening. You know, so I may think that it's maybe because of my karma that I am feeling very well, but you have no idea. We have no idea why I am feeling so well. Maybe because of, you know, some master or some little fellow somewhere decided that, okay, let me pray for all sentient beings that maybe they be happy and may they be, you know, free of suffering, and you suddenly feel good. You know, so that is a very, very simple, as Ashpriya was talking about, simplicity. You know, it's a very simple thing to do. Although, again, easier said than done, because many a times we are not in a state of praying. Many a times the ego is so heavy. And even in that situation, if I can recognize when I am going through an intense egoistic, you know, a kind of a challenge, if I can recognize that, yes, this is suffering, may all beings who are going through this suffering be liberated and be free of this suffering. Instantly you change the game. You are not focused on you yourself anymore. And you will see that even the suffering kind of subsides because the focus on me has gone. So even in the midst of the grip of egoistic state of consciousness, I think that's the best we can do. We connect with the beings who are suffering like me in this ego, and may all of us be rid of this suffering. You know, and you have done your job. You have helped it. You know, you have helped the whole movement forward. So this, I think the crux in this prayer, as all of us were, you know, sharing, to strive to do them the utmost possible good, that is to help them as best as one can in making the supreme discovery, the discovery of thee within them. And one of the most beautiful ways is to use your suffering to pray that may every being who is going through this suffering be free of suffering. And so if we have changed our inner state and we have connected with all the beings, there is oneness there. And now I'm no more focused on the egoistic state. You know, so the game, instantly the game changes. That's the power of prayer. Now that we are on prayers and meditations, that's the power. And whenever, you know, yes, Shweta. You want to share?
No, it's very beautiful. Yeah.
you know, whenever like we are on the, you know, roads, signals are there, traffic signals. Why do we need red lights? We need red lights because everyone is running in their ego consciousness. Oh my God, I have to get, you know, I will get late. I have to be the first. So we are not sensitive. The moment I am not in the egoistic consciousness, I would not need a red light. So mother says that all these little ethics and moralities, why are they needed? Why are these little steps and rules needed? Red light, why is the red light needed? Because I am mostly living from an egoistic state of consciousness. My whole focus is on meri needs kaise fulfill ho jaye, how I must become more fulfilled. So I don't bother about anyone. But the moment this shift happens within, then we would not need red lights on the roads. Everyone is sensitive enough. Everyone is keeping others first. You know, you go first. Okay, you go first. Oh, that can lead to another traffic jam. That's a different matter. You know, but then rules are not necessary. So mother is talking about rules, that why do we need this? And these rules can be very, very supple. Not to make very rigid conceptions about it, because the moment I am in the beingness, the moment I am in touch with my true beingness, you will be directed what is the next step to do. The direction comes from within. Most often than not, we don't get directions. Why? Because we live identified with thoughts, feelings, and me and my story. So what has to happen for me, this supreme discovery, first has to happen within me. You know, that can I now become, as Ashpriya was pointing, you know, more flexible? How can I become more flexible? Not to identify too much rigidly with my thoughts, my ideas, my opinions, and my feelings. Take a step back, and then flexibility happens. You know, so this supreme discovery has to happen within the being first. And along with that, it is impossible that you do not touch other hearts. It is impossible. If a rose is there, you cannot miss the fragrance. If a lotus is there, you cannot miss the beauty. You know? So if I am still a drain, people will point at me. And it's good that they point at me, because I still have to transfigure into a flower. You know? So the only job is on us. And having said that, the best I can do for others is always wishing others the best. And may they all never sway away from their own true essence. All of them march towards the true essence within, because that is where we get the liberation from all the suffering. No one can be happy. You know, all that we want for others is happiness, right? All that I want for the others is may they be happy. But what is genuine happiness? Genuine happiness cannot be got if I am not in touch with my true nature. It will just be a fleeting happiness, come and go. You know, I'll be empty again. So can I also add in my prayers that may all the beings discover their true nature. As I am discovering, may all the beings discover their true nature. Because that is the supreme discovery, which will give them genuine happiness. So I think that is in short, really. And whenever sun is there, the bulbs are not needed. You know, when the sun shines in full glory, then little lights, like, you know, it's nighttime and Diwali lights are there. Now, these Diwali lights are looking so beautiful in the darkness. But the moment sun arises in the morning, they will have no existence. No one could actually, admire their beauty. So such is the beauty of discovering our true nature, that the little lights that we have, although they may be helpful on the way, they were helpful, but they become absolutely non-essential. The little rules that we make, the rigid, you know, kind of things that we make in between. The moment sun is there shining in its full glory, the Diwali lights in the morning time, they have no existence in front of sun. You know, so such is the beauty of recognition and also living our true nature out. You know? And it's simple then. That's what we were talking earlier, that it becomes more and more simple and flexible. Yeah. So anything anyone wants to add in this, on this? Any further reflection?
Yeah, so I just want to say that, you know, like it's really indeed been a journey, like exactly the way Mother is saying, from, you know, like rules, that is superficial rules. Like I have been somebody who's like, you know, followed in my 20s something, 30s something, the beliefs have changed, and you know, then I'm, so right, wrong, moral, immoral, everything, you know, all these things, you know, like I feel most of us, all of us go through, and then now I understand this. So that's what I was saying in the, you know, like in the beginning, that yeah, you go through all these things, you know, good, bad, right, wrong, all that. So yeah, so it's very profound, you know, this learning. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. And then, you know, as we understand it in our life, then yeah, we're also able to make space for these flexibility in other people's, you know, around us, that yes, you know, things keep on changing.
Yeah, yeah. And also, I feel the suffering was because of that egoic ignorance, yeah, you know, so it comes out of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, Rashmiji, if you want to add on something, since your internet is not very stable, if you want to add on right now.
Can I see the prayer, please?
Okay, yes, yes, sure.
I see there are two extreme ends. One is one who is integrally united with the divine. Rules, no external rules is necessary. And Mother also saying that no rule is vast and supple enough to be perfectly adapted to thy law. Only for those who are actually, who are having, I include myself in that, for having an intermittent contact with the rules, may be actually necessary for us to keep us in the path, mean the path, but there is a constant revision has to be there of those rules is imperative. And what helps me in that actually is the constant communication with the divine. Then as I progress in the path, the rules will get automatically changed. It will get constantly revised. And maybe when I'm integrally united with him, maybe I'll go beyond all the law. So that constant communication is a thing that I have to practice. That is what I might take away from this. Constant communication. Thank you.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you so much. Absolutely. I think that's most essential, this constant communion that you're talking of. Without this, and many a times it happens that we think that mera ho gaya. You know, this is the biggest, you know, stumbling block that happens, that mera ho gaya, you know, that once we have a beautiful experience of communion, but we don't, we realize the more and more we walk on this path, that hamara kabhi hoga nahi. You know, it's like we continuously have to keep communion with this divine part in us, the light, the love, this pure part in us. It just has to be constant, because the dirt keeps on getting collected again and again. Just like at our homes, you know, we keep on dusting again and again every day. So just like that, the entanglements keep on coming, showing them up. And if I am in constant communion, as Rashmiji was pointing out, then only I can actually step away from the wheel of karma. The moment I change my attitude and the moment I listen to that direction coming from within. So I think that's really almost the crux that you touched upon. Yeah.
And another thing that really helps, and which also you pointed out, that, you know, if we can sincerely pray for somebody, any of my relatives, anybody whom I know, if I really pray for him or her, an earnest prayer, that will help more than rather than telling them something to do. That helps. And yeah. And a sense of goodwill should always for people like us who are actually aspiring to lead a life turned towards the divine, they will not do any harm. Actually, we will not, in our conscious will, will not do any harm.
Beautiful.
So a sense of goodwill will always guide us. That means let the other person be happy. I am not going to do anything wrong with him. But a prayer will always go forth from my heart. So in that way, that will also help me, in my progress.
If absolutely. I sense, absolutely.
Sense of that goodwill. That means I am not taking any muck, not taking any dirt actually. I'm not creating any dirt inside myself.
Beautiful.
So goodwill helps in any relations actually. Any relation, even if you are going through a bad patch also, goodwill helps. You will come out of that is for sure. And the best part is that if my other end is already charged up with my constant communication with the divine, then I don't have any fear of the fall. Thank you.
Very beautiful. Even I was going to say that, like, though challenges increase, and but now uncertainty doesn't scare you like before. So that is what even I feel.
Beautiful. Yes,
I also think
please go ahead. It's nothing really. Please go.
I just wanted to say, add to Rashmiji's point, that that when we actually pray for the other person, we are also controlling that I-ness in us, that I have to interfere and make a difference to that other person's life, because we can't really, to be honest. And that praying for that other person is actually really, it makes us connect to ourselves also much more deeply. And it's a much, it's actually a way to become more humble to life, that I really can't do much. Although at times, if help is sought from us, we probably have to. But beyond that, we can't, to be honest. And that's when you pray for that other person and leave it there.
Absolutely. And I think when we sit in our silences and we begin to really have intention of a goodwill, as Rashmiji and Shweta and Ashpriya were sharing, towards someone else, you would see that there are many, many people in your life. Naturally, there is something in us which is resisting that goodwill. If you have ever recognized that, that although... on the surface you may think that you are willing good for that person, but there is something that doesn't want
something. That's why I said that it is very if you can do it, it's very difficult actually.
At
times it is really, if you are not in that exact state of pain, it is very difficult to really, really pray. You can just I mean, that deep prayer will not really come from your inside.
I think that's where it's our challenge. We are thinking that the challenge is outside somewhere, but it's my challenge. There is separation within my being. Beautiful. So whenever we actually pray for someone, especially for people who are anti us, who are in opposition of us, I think try to experiment with this, having a goodwill for them. Something which is really blocking the path will clear away. It works like acid almost, that drains is blocked and you add acid and that it gets cleared away. So the moment I begin to have goodwill for a person who I actually hate, or not really, I don't tell that I hate, but there is certain resistance towards that person. The moment you say, may that person be free of suffering, may he or she recognize his true nature. I think the more and more we do this, you see that you liberate actually your own self from the bondage. So beautiful it is, really.
And the difficulty is also with people whom we love, because whom we hate, we know that that is one emotion that we have. But the problem, there are people, I'm sure everyone will resonate with that. There are people in our life whom we love, but at times, or there are certain aspects of that person which make them suffer and which make me suffer. That there, you know, that prayer becomes, you know, because it will come to, I mean, it's a very, you know, it's very challenging to really pray for that person, because the moment you start praying, that action which was not very nice to you comes in front of you, and then you can't really, you know, pray with that depth or that intensity or
exactly.
that sincerity.
Exactly. I think this is very important, because this is this resistance that we feel within when we are praying for someone. This is the stumbling block. You know, this is what we, and I think we must push ourselves to pray. There we can push actually. We try to push in several other directions. Because the moment I push it a little, whenever I feel a little ready for it, you know, I see that I actually clear up the path. I liberate the other person from my bondage, and I liberate my own self from bondage. And many a times, as you were sharing, people who we claim that we love, we don't really want to have that goodwill for them, that may they discover their true nature. Because if someone discovers their true nature, they are not attached to you anymore. So if you are insecure, you cannot pray this, no? If I'm insecure. Because the moment I discover my true nature, although I will have genuine compassion and love for everyone, but I would not be bonded to anyone. I would not be attached to anyone. So it's a, you know, very interesting experiment, I think. Yeah. Yeah, great. So I think we have lots to experiment in our life. It gives us a kind of a thing to experiment on the path. Thank you so much, everyone, for sharing so beautifully, reflecting and
beautiful, Monica. Really,
yeah,
beautiful.
Yeah.
What you, you said, no, actually, well, which person you have to pray? Yeah, this is my take home point.
Yeah.
Thank you, Monica.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Thanks. Bye bye.